Good afternoon, everybody. You are about to watch Deeper Life Bible Church program, the Moment of Transformation. Today, by the grace of the Lord, we shall listen to our pastor, General Superintendent, Pastor W.F. Kumoye. You are going to be blessed. It is my wish that you call your family to come and listen to you as our pastor is blessing you with his holiness message. Be blessed.
On the needs of other people, and you're reaching out to them, and you forget yourself, and you forget your problem, and you forget your own load and your own burden, you'll find while you are helping other people to come to know the Lord, and you're bringing them to the kingdom, the Lord will be taking care of you and taking care of your problems. They that weep as though they wept not. Do you know there are even churches that will say, you're talking about planning crusade for our city here. Why are you talking about that? You know, the money we have, you want to spend everything just planning for crusade. Look at the need in the church. Look at the people there, they don't have enough to eat. And the people there, they don't have that. If we tell you, our brethren, our members, so are weeping, that, you know, we need to just concentrate everything we have in the church, spend it on them. They that weep as though they wept not, don't concentrate on problems, concentrate on possibilities. The possibilities of reaching out to the people that need to hear the gospel, the people that need to hear the word of the Lord, and come to the Lord. And then you are going to bring joy to the angels of God in heaven, and joy will come to your life as well in Jesus' name. So then, let's concentrate on the word of God, giving it to the people that are perishing. Another reason it's a compelling necessity is that there's a certainty of eternal judgment of the lost. The certainty of eternal judgment. Hebrews chapter 9, verse 27. Hebrews chapter 9, verse 27. And as it is appointed unto men, once to die, but after this, the judgment. The reality of judgment, the certainty of judgment, the imminence of judgment. It is soon to come. And that's the reason why we need to reach out to the people so that they will be saved. You know what we're talking about? We're talking about recovering the art of the lost art of personal evangelism. And now we understand we need to have this compelling necessity registered on our heart. And you know that we need to recover this so that we can go back to our first love, our first enthusiasm, our first passion, our first zeal, reaching out to the people that need to be saved. It will be done. Yeah. We're coming to point number three now, commitment needed for personal evangelism. Commitment needed for personal evangelism. But you know what? Even after we have known all the things that we're studying, you know, somebody said, knowledge is power. No. Applied knowledge is power. It's not just knowledge. It's the knowledge you take, you digest, you assimilate, you meditate upon, and you act upon. That's the kind of knowledge that is power. If you hear people say, knowledge is power, no, it's applied knowledge, practical knowledge, knowledge that makes you to do something, you rise up, you cannot rest anymore. That knowledge of the need of sinners, that knowledge of the passion, the desire in the heart of the Almighty God, that knowledge that you, an instrument now in the hand of God, then you rise up and you go to tell them, that's the knowledge, practical, applied, that drives you. That's the knowledge that is power. And that's why, if you have such knowledge, you have looked at the word of God, you have heard the word of God, and you have assimilated the word of God, you are meditating on the word of God, is going to lead you to commitment. That's why we have this point number three, commitment needed for personal evangelism. And there will be something in your heart that will want to say, I will do something. Luke chapter 4. Luke chapter 4. We're looking at verse 43. Luke chapter 4. verse 43. And he said unto them, I must preach the kingdom of God to all the cities also. For therefore am I sent. Look at that word, preach. I must preach. Remove that P there. What's left? Reach. Reach them. You see, there are people that are saying, but you know, I am preaching. I'm asking you, who are you reaching? Reach them. If you are really preaching, you'll be reaching people. You'll be touching the lives of people. Look at that word, preach. Remove that R. What remains? Each of them. Each of them. You're going to each person. You know the people that just say, I preach, and then I'm asking them, or we're asking them, are you reaching out? No, all I want to do is just to preach. No, you cannot preach without reaching them. You reach their heart. You reach them at the point where they are. And it is that reaching them that actually makes the preaching meaningful. And then you are reaching each one. Go ye to all the world and preach the gospel to every creature, each creature. And so he tells us here, the Lord Jesus Christ said, I must preach the kingdom of God to all the cities also. For therefore am I sent. And if you have come to the church and you don't know yet why you are sent, therefore am I sent. And you're still wasting quite a lot of time. And the Lord is saying, friend, child, what you are doing is not what I sent you for. These things are good. In your extra time, you should do them almost like hobby. But the real thing you ought to do, and the real important essential thing, is to get to each person and reach them and preach to them and bring them into the kingdom. And except we're doing that, we have not done yet what we're called to do. Reach them, preach to them. We're told in Acts of the Apostles, chapter 9, Acts chapter 9, reading from verse 15. Acts chapter 9, reading from verse 15. Here it says, but the Lord said unto him, go thy way, for he is a chosen vessel unto me. I'm a chosen vessel. I said I'm a chosen vessel. You know, you should see yourself not an ordinary person, ordinary brother, ordinary sister. The Lord's hand is upon you. And because the Lord's calling is upon you, you don't see yourself just as everybody else. Just, you know, doing what everybody else is doing. Going the direction everybody else is going. Understand, you are a chosen vessel. Paul was a chosen vessel in his own generation. And you in your own generation, you are a chosen vessel. Go thy way, for he is a chosen vessel to bear my name before the Gentiles and kings and the children of Israel. I'm going to ask you, what if Paul the Apostle, after the Lord called him? Understand, Paul the Apostle was a highly educated man in his own generation. Paul the Apostle was a highly placed person among the Sanhedrin. You know the Sanhedrin, they are the political hierarchies of the day. What if he now said, now I have the light, now I have the knowledge, now I have the Spirit of God. I am going to transform these politics in Israel. And I'm going to transform all these people that are doing, because now I have the power of God and the Spirit of God. If he went there and he joined politics, the Sanhedrin, and he says, I am back. All of you, of course you know me, I'm Saul of Tarsus. I met Jesus Christ. Now I have power and I have this and that. Whatever he did in that place will be a waste of his time. Because in the case of this Paul I'm talking about, he was a chosen vessel. And as a chosen vessel, what he was to do was very clearly marked out for him. And he wasn't free to just go here and say, I'm going to do this, I'm going to do this, I'm going to do that. A lot of believers today, you have ambition. ambition here, ambition there, ambition in the other place. The question is, if you know you are a chosen vessel, what has he chosen you to do? To bear my name before the Gentiles, and then before kings and the children of Israel. For I will show him how great things he must suffer for my name's sake. And then we're told that Ananias went his way and entered into the house, and putting his hand on him, said, Brother Saul, the Lord, even Jesus that appeared unto thee in the way as thou camest, has sent me, that thou mightest receive thy sight and be filled with the Holy Ghost. I pray afresh, the Holy Ghost will come upon you. Amen. And the Lord will actually use you mightily in Jesus' name. We're looking at 1 Corinthians chapter 15. 1 Corinthians chapter 15. Now you know, you are a chosen vessel, and the Lord has called you and commissioned you to get something done. How are you going to do it? Here it says in 1 Corinthians chapter 15, verse 58, Therefore, my beloved brethren, the word, therefore, because you are called, because you are chosen, because you are appointed, because you are a watchman, because you are a soul winner, because the Lord has committed something into your hand. Therefore, my beloved brethren, be ye steadfast. Be ye steadfast. That word steadfast there. Why don't you look up for a moment in the, you see the, Paul the Apostle, I told you, he was a master of the Greek language. And he knew, Paul the Apostle knew how they talked about the word steadfast. You know, he was a tent maker. And as a tent maker, he will go to a particular area. He will study the condition of that place there. If the wind was blowing very much there, he knows the kind of wind that blew there. And as a tent maker, he will put a tent down. And then all the stakes, all the strings of the tent, it will test it and shake it and know that it is steadfast. When he used that word steadfast, what it meant is no wind can blow that tent down. That's the way they used the word steadfast at that time. And Paul, as a tent maker, he was very, very familiar when he said steadfast. And the Lord is telling us, be you then, be ye steadfast. That means the winds will blow, winds of trial, and winds of temptation, and winds of difficulty. But it says, be steadfast. Plant your feet on solid ground, that whatever may come, and whatever may go, and whatever difficulties you have, the winds and the storms that will blow, you know that this is the activity, and this is the work, and this is the assignment the Lord has given you. Be ye steadfast, that you will not say, you know, I really wanted to ever. And I made up my mind, I was going to do this and this and do that. But you know, the wind began to blow. And as the wind began to blow now, if you were myself, what would you have done? Because I lost my job, I became sick, I became weak, and then I had a lot of persecution, I had a lot of, that's why the Lord is saying, be ye therefore steadfast. That even though the wind may blow, this evangelism will not be taken away from your life. And then it says, unmovable. Now you understand that word, steadfast. You know that there are some things so well here that will almost move you away from where the Lord has put you. That word unmovable once again. It's like, you know, Paul the Apostle, he was choosing those words by the revelation of the Spirit of God very carefully. Unmovable. Unmovable. They use that word in the olden days in the Greek literature for the people that were, you know, they built a particular thing. And it's not going away from the tent. It's not going to a solid building. Because, you know, in the case of a tent, when he finished whatever I was doing there, he removed the tent and go to another place. But now, he said, because I use the word steadfast, you may think that, all right, after some time now, we'll move. I'm using the word steadfast for you to know that the wind should not blow you down. But now I'm telling you that make it like a solid building. That it is not moving like a tent. That it is there. You come this year, it's there. You come the following year, it's there. And how many of you have the experience when you were back at home? There was a building, whenever you entered the town, you saw the building there. And then you came over here, and then you traded after some years, you went back home, and lo and behold, you saw the building there. And then you come back over here, and then after some years again, you want to visit home, and you saw the building there. That's the word, unmovable. That you are stable. You're like a solid rock. And no matter what is happening, no matter what comes and what goes, no matter the circumstances, you are unmovable in the work of the Lord, in the evangelism that the Lord has called us to do. That no matter what is happening, no matter who goes, who comes, what happens, what does not happen, you become unmovable, always abounding. Always abounding. It is very clear in the work of the Lord. And what is the work of the Lord? But to win souls into the kingdom. Always abounding in the work of the Lord. For as much as ye know that your labor is not in vain in the Lord, your labor will not be in vain. As we summarize, you remember we're talking about recovering the lost art of personal evangelism. If we're actually going to recover the lost art of personal evangelism, what's the implication? Number one, it means we recover our passion. Two, our desire. Three, our zeal. Four, our fire. And five, our energy. Six, our enthusiasm. And seven, becomes our lifestyle. That means then you say, yes, that's exactly what I want to do. I want to recover the lost art of personal evangelism, passion, passion within you. That's what to recover. And then desire, a kind of burning desire that puts a burden within you. And then your zeal and the fire, that the fire is burning and you're never cold. And you never lukewarm about this. And the energy, spiritual energy and enthusiasm and lifestyle. If that is going to happen and we're going to recover this lost art of personal evangelism, what does it take? Number one, realize. Realize. You're going to realize when you sit down and you say, 1976, this is the way I was. 1978, this was my passion, my zeal, my fire, my enthusiasm, my spiritual energy. And this was my program. This was the way I spent my time. 1985, this was the way I was spending my time evangelizing. And then you come to this day now, 2006. Ah, there's a lot of difference between 2006 and 1986 or 1989 or 1993. The time when I was really burning for the Lord. The first thing to do, if you're going to recover this passion, this fire, this zeal, this enthusiasm, this energy, this lifestyle, this zeal and desire, is realize. Number two, repent of your negligence. You realize, oh Lord, I see there's a difference.